apologize everybody for the delay. Apparently there was an accident on 101, and since we invited so many external people, we wanted to make sure everybody had time to get here before the talk started. And again, I want to thank everybody for coming. We're really excited to have everybody here to hear this talk. We're also really excited to have a special guest speaker. Norman comes here all the way from Germany, and he's going to give us a talk about Netty and best practices for using it. He actually is one of the core devs on the Netty project, so you're getting a pretty authoritative source here.
And also
he's got a book coming out.
Netty in Action.
When is it due out?
Hopefully in April. Actually, it will be the final draft, maybe in April, and then it takes about maybe 3 months or so. We will see. And Andrew wrote a chapter, or a part of a chapter on that, so it's pretty cool.
All right. So thanks, everybody. We'll get started.
Yeah. Okay. Everybody hear me? Okay, perfect. So what I want to do is, I think everybody of you used Netty already, or at least touched it. So I want to skip all the introduction, because I hope you all know about this and how it works. So we'll just give you a little bit of a best practice talk. I want to show you how you can improve your code and hopefully make it faster. If you have any questions, you can just give them at the end of the presentation, or just, well, catch me later. I mean, I'm here anyway. So I hope you will enjoy it. Okay. So the first slide, as always it is, a little bit about me. I'm working for Red Hat. I'm basically working full-time on Netty itself and also on Vertex, which is kind of an asynchronous platform which allows you to write a polyglot code. You can write in JavaScript, Python, Ruby, whatever you like, and love, Scala. There's a lot of things you can do. And I'm doing all kind of things when it comes to non-blocking IO. Whatever we need. Then I'm writing a book for Manning. It's called Netty in Action. You actually can already buy it. It's in early access. So if you're interested, do it. I have a Twitter handle. If you're interested in rants, sometimes technical stuff, follow me. Maybe it's interesting, maybe not. You will see. And most of my code is on GitHub, because I'm working for Red Hat. It's open source. So yay. Just have a look. And we will see. So, agenda. What I want to talk about today is different things. Mainly it's about pipelining, how you can do pipelining for different protocols that support that and so get most out of the speed, like for example HTTP, SMTP, or whatever. GC pressure. I think most of you had problems with GC pressure if you push it hard enough. We did a lot of things in Netty 4 to improve that, because it was pretty bad in Netty 3 compared to Netty 4. I mean, it was fast, but it was not as good as it should be. So that was one of the main reasons why we actually broke the whole API. It's not fun for the users that upgrade, but it wasn't possible to do it anyway in the other way, so we had to do that. It's a major release. Why not? How you write gracefully, what does it mean? How you handle slow clients, for example, slow connections, and you don't run out of memory exceptions or error or whatever. So that's a common problem with non-blocking IO. And also about buffers best practice, how you handle buffers, how you get stuff out of buffers, what you do with them, how it works. And about the event loop, which powers the connections, which is basically a thread that just gets all the stuff of a selector and just handle it. All right, so let's keep on moving. So what we actually see here is it's a pretty simple piece of code in Netty. I hope it's big enough to see that. What it basically does is we have this kind of class which is called simple channel inbound handler, which basically just allows to override different methods. In this case, it's a channel read method. What the channel read method does is it gets notified as soon as there's something that was read for this channel, for this connection. Like, for example, just some bytes, whatever. And it gets called, and then you basically can do something with that. What we do here is we create a response for the received stuff, and then we write it back and flush it, which means it goes directly to a socket, return a future, which gets notified once a read actually happens because it's asynchronous. It could happen now or later or never. If it's closed, it would just fail. And if it's not a keep alive HTTP stuff, we close the connection because that's just how the protocol works. And this is pretty similar to what you had in channel 3, in Netty 3, when you called channel write. We changed the semantic a little bit, which I will explain in the next slide why we did that. So basically, each write and flush is basically on syscall, which you do to write the stuff to a socket. That's pretty bad in terms of performance because syscall are pretty expensive. So what we allow in Netty 4 now is to minimize syscalls for protocols that allow pipelining. How you can do that is basically you have the same implementation or type of implementation. And what we do now, we use write. Oh, there's an error slide. It should just be called write net and in the end. Oh, we'll fix that later. And create the response and say, if it's not keep alive, we also add this handler, this listener, which closes the connection. But then there's another method you can override, which is called generate complete, which is triggered as soon as there's nothing more to read on that channel. There's no more bytes that receive. And then we flush. That means if you have HTTP pipelining and receive, for example, 10 requests in one byte buffer, the general read method will be called 10 times. You will call write. It goes through the pipeline, but it's not flushed on the socket yet. It's a little bit like an outbound buffer stream where you write, and at the end, if you want to make sure that everything is written, you call flush. And this minimizes syscalls because before you would have 10 syscalls, now you have only one syscall. And all of this is done internally by Netty with the gathering write. So you only have one syscall which wraps all the buffers in an array and just write it away, which is a lot faster than before. That was not possible on Netty 3. I mean, you could build it by your own. You can just build up a queue or whatever. But now it comes out of the box for you. And if you have a protocol like HTTP, SMTP, or whatever that supports that kind of operations, you should do that. All right? So, related to this, what we have is basically we have different operations. First off, we have write. What write does is it just passes a message completely through the pipeline and it lands in the outbound buffer if it goes through the pipeline. It's not written yet, it's not, no syscall. Then we have flush, which means everything that was written before gets flushed now, which was not flushed before. And then we have write and flush, which is basically just a shortcut to do first write and then flush. It's just a little bit lower, well, less typing. I mean, just a little bit nicer. And the good thing is about this, like I said before, it really limits the flushes to this amount you want. You can also do all kinds of cool things with that. For example, we have some user which do auto flushes every whatever bytes. So once you write, for example, 8K out of the channel, you automatically flush. You just have a handler for that. You can flush, for example, every second, whatever, to batch stuff up. That's pretty amazing. I mean, you can do a lot of stuff with that. It's pretty flexible. But also, write is not, well, you don't, write, for write, you need to pay some price. It's not for free either, because the thing is, if you call write, you will pass it through the pipeline. And the pipeline contains the handler that actually do something with that. And if you have a lot of handlers inside there, you have a lot of stuff to move through. So you should not call write more often than it's needed anyway. So it's still kind of, you just think about it, what do you do? Garbage collector pressure, one of my favorite topics. Anyone of you never had problems with garbage collector pressure? That's pretty good. Nobody. I really like that. Well, actually, it's bad to have these problems, but if you have the problems, it means you push it pretty hard, which is good. So the problem we actually had in Netty 3 was whenever we received an event, which could be something was read from the channel, there is some write that's going on, some connections, whatever. What we did was we created a new message event and then wraps the information inside there and fired through the pipeline. That sounds pretty good. It was not pretty good because we created one extra object per event, which is pretty bad in terms of GC stuff because creating them, it's not a big deal. I mean, it's not for free, but the big deal is to get rid of them later, just to collect them. And we had some crazy stuff going on. The garbage collector was just freaking out, running all the time. And what we did for that, first off, was in Netty 4, we replaced this kind of model with invoking directly methods. So what we had in Netty 3 was we had basically two methods for inbound and outbound handler, and we just fired off the event through them. And the user would do some instant off-checking, whatever, to find out if it was a read event, write event, whatever. What we did in Netty 4 was we add one dedicated method per event type. So we have, for example, channel active, which is called once a socket connection is established. We have channel inactive, which is called once the socket is closed. Channel read, when something was written, then write, when something gets written, and all that kind of stuff. And then we also have, because we want to be flexible, we want to allow the user to give the power that he can do whatever he wants with the pipeline in his handler. We also have this kind of, it's called user event triggered. So you can just fire off a poach or whatever through the whole pipeline and do an instant off check or whatever and just handle it by yourself. So you still have the same flexibility, but for the core events, the GC overhead is pretty low compared to before. And another thing we actually had trouble with in Netty 3 was that for every write, we created a new channel future. Because for the channel future, you can register the listener, they get notified once the write is done. But often, people don't care about that. They just write it off and want to get, well, they would get notified anywhere when the channel is closed or whatever. So what we introduced was a void promise, we call it like this, void channel promise, which you can pass in now in the write call, and so it's static. You will not get notified at all, but the write is much more cheaper. The downside of that is, basically, you can only do that if you have no channel handler inside there that needs this channel promise. For example, if you have SSL handler or something like that in there, you may need it because of handshaking. But for most of the use cases, you don't need that if you don't care about it. So, writing too fast. It's a pretty common problem because many users many people are just used to this blocking I/O stuff. So you write to an output stream and if it can't handle that, it just blocks. It's not a big deal. When you do non-blocking I/O, it's a big deal because it will just buffer this stuff in some kind of queue until it's ready to write it. And if you write pretty quick, you may get out of memory errors. So what we actually do is, let's first show them bad code. Here's the bad code. So what we do here is, while there's some need to write something, we just loop over it and write it through the channel. That's it. No kind of checking, it's a Q4, whatever. We just write all the time. And you see that pretty often. That's not good. What is better is we have this kind of different event for that, actually. So let us first go to channel active. Channel active calls write if possible. And write if possible has this while loop, but checks if channel is writable, which means can the channel take any more data before some threshold is hit, which you can configure, which we see in the next page. And if not, stop writing. And then we have this method, which is called channel writability changed, which is called as soon as the channel comes writable again or not writable again. And there you can just call this method again, and keep on writing. So this is kind of a flow control. And it makes it pretty easy and flexible to make sure that you don't fill up, well, the whole heap or whatever, or direct buffers, whatever you write. All right? And that's actually what these options are for. So we have two options for that. It's called write buffer high watermark and write buffer low watermark. Why we have two of them? Basically, what we do is we have this high watermark. If this is reached, we say channel is writable false. And it stays like this until the write buffer low watermark is hit. So it gives some time to recover. Because otherwise, you would just start writing again, and you would get the event again pretty soon, I guess at least. And you can set this just directly on the bootstrap. I mean, the bootstrap is there to configure the channel, to fire up anything. You just set it there, that's it. And besides the bootstrap, you can also set it directly on the channel, so you can even have different kind of config for different kind of channels, if you like. It really depends. I mean, it's pretty flexible. Yeah, custom events. Like I said, you can just use this user event trigger to handle them. What makes it pretty good fit for all kind of custom notification? For example, we use it for handshaking for the WebSocket stuff. So once the WebSocket stuff is done, we'll get this event. You can just check instant off, whatever. And can see and can put up some more handlers in the pipeline, disconnect, whatever you like. So it kind of to extend the normal events that you have. Maybe one important thing to say about that I forgot about on the slide is, but even if you do that, you should take care to not create too much object. Often you can handle this kind of stuff with just statics, instance stuff. Or enums or whatever, because you don't need any more information. So be careful. So we have two different kind of codecs or decoders actually to make it kind of easy to write your own decoder that decode from bytes to some kind of POCHO. Most of the people use replaying decoder because it's easier, but it comes with some price. What we basically do in replaying decoders, we give you the illusion that you can handle this kind of stuff like you did before with blocking I/O, which is not true. I mean, basically, it's not true. Because what we do is, if you do an operation on the byte buff, like said, read long, we try to read along, and if there's not enough room in the buffer, we just throw a special error. That Netty knows about, we catch that, read that, the indexes, and then it gets notified again if more data is there. I mean, this error, it's static. It's static final instance, so you don't need to care about garbage collector pressure and all the kind of things, but throwing and catching is still not for free. And also checking and resetting the index, it all needs to get done proper, so it has some overhead. So my rule of thumb is, if you can handle your protocol with byte-to-message decoder, which actually is the same like replaying decoder, but you need to check before every operation if there are enough bytes in there that you can read, because otherwise you would get index out of bound exception or buffer overflow or whatever. If you can handle that protocol with byte-to-message decoder without it becomes a mess, do it, because it's just faster. If it's really complex protocol, you maybe start with replaying decoder, and later on you can replace it if it doesn't scale or whatever. It's just harder to do. I mean, it's not too hard to do. It's just harder. It's just you need to remember to check the readable bytes and whatever. It's not too hard. Yeah, what we have in Netty 4 now is we have a pooled byte buff allocator. That's basically, we allow to pre-create buffers, byte buffs, and use it out of a pool. It's based on a Jim Mallock paper and the modifications from Facebook, which are pretty awesome. So the problem with on-pool powers is it's pretty slow. It's just pretty slow because any one of you ever looked at OpenJDK, okay, then you know why it's slow, but I will tell. It's pretty slow because, first off, they try to handle direct buffers with a garbage collector, which doesn't work because they are direct buffers. If you only allocate direct buffers, the garbage collector will maybe never run because there's not enough stuff in the heap to let it run. So what they try to do is they try to give the garbage collector a hind with system GC to run. And you have also funny things like thread sleep 100 in the allocation path, which works pretty well if you allocate fast enough. So that's one of the reasons why allocation doesn't work too well. Freeing up direct buffers, forget about it. It doesn't work either because basically they try to handle it with the garbage collector. So to get around this, because this doesn't work well enough, you may not free it up fast enough, what actually the users do is they get a reference to the cleaner implementation, which is internal to direct byte buffer implementation, and then call cleaner clean on that, which basically says free up that pointer. The problem with that is it's static synchronized. So if you do a lot of the allocation out of different threads, it doesn't work. I mean, it works, it's just slow. And we want to have high performance stuff. That's why we want to use Netty. So because of this limitation, basically, what we did was it's pooled buffers. So it's pretty easy to just enable them. You just set it again on the bootstrap. Here it's a client bootstrap, but it could also be a server bootstrap, whatever. You just set this pool bypass allocator, and here I use the default settings, but you can tune it a lot like you want. So basically what we do there is when we pre-allocate them, we if you try to get a new buffer, we look up the different sizes that are in the pool because of the J malloc stuff. And where it fits, we just grab one out, use it, and once you're done, you call release and it's pulled back. It's pretty simple, actually. But it's a lot faster from the point of allocation to just do this kind of hacks. We will see how much faster it is on the next slide. The thing is with pool byte buffer allocator, it's not really, you still need to config it to get it right for your workload. At least that was true since till the last release. We will fix that in Netty 4.0.18. What we basically did was we watched again the smart guys of Facebook, and they basically did for jmalloc thread caches for buffers. Before, I mean, what you need to know about jmalloc is it tries to divide buffers in different arenas, and the arenas are spread across the threads. This should give you less conditions when you try to allocate stuff because you need to synchronize. But if you have enough threads, you get condition anyway. Not enough, not too much, but you get a condition. To fix that, we basically just implemented thread cache that also was mentioned by Facebook in the papers and in the videos. There's a pretty good talk on that that you can find. What we do there is we have thread local caches. So whenever you try to allocate, we look up in the thread local, is there something cached that fits this size in? If not, we go to the arena, synchronize, get it out. If you try to release it again, we try to put it in the cache if there's enough room. If there's enough room, we just put in the cache, no synchronization because of free up. So when you need to allocate a new buffer the next time, it would just get served right out of the thread local cache, no synchronization, no conditioned. It's pretty fast. The only problem you have there is there may be some threads that stop to allocate at some point. And because they are in the caches, they will not be in the arena, and so you cannot get them from different other threads. So what we do there is we have some kind of threshold, which says there's some threshold that we configure, and after so many allocations, we will just check the caches if there's something in that was not allocated for the last round. If so, we just free it up and put it back in the arenas. That's the whole magic. And because everyone loves diagrams, everyone loves. Justin of Twitter, he's the other guy that works mostly full-time on Netty. He did some benchmarks for Twitter. I would try to explain it a little bit because I think it's a little bit, maybe a bit too small, but you can get it later anyway. So what we tried to benchmark here was we did different kind of allocations. First of the blue ones are unpooled heap buffers. Then the yellow one is pooled heap buffers. Then we have the red one, which is unpooled direct buffers. Direct buffers are allocated outside of the heap. That's the one you actually want to use, because if you don't use direct buffers, the OpenJDK and Oracle JDK will do in-memory copy internally before they write to the socket, because otherwise it doesn't work. So you have one extra memory copy if you just pass in some non-direct buffers. And then we have pooled direct buffers. And what you see there, even for heap buffers, which are just byte arrays, it makes much more difference to pool them. Now, the question is why it makes so much difference. What you need to know about is if you allocate a new array out of the JavaWidget machine of the heap, it needs to be zeroed out. Because basically, they prevent you to read all data. And the thing is, for buffers, you most of the times don't need that, because you have these indexes on the buffers where you have writer, reader index, and we can save that if you want to. You don't need to pull heap buffers, but we allow you. And for direct buffers, it's basically just because direct buffers to allocate is much slower than heap buffers. And you also have this kind of, well, thread sleeve, whatever. And I think you see when we have big buffers of about 16 kilobytes, it's a pretty much a difference. Yeah, that's what I said before. You always want to write direct buffers, because otherwise the implementation just do a memory copy. You don't want to do memory copy because it's just overhead, it's just slow. And if you use a pool, you can allocate direct buffers pretty fast. So just use them. There may be situations where you need heap buffers because you have some APIs that need to act on arrays. But most of the times, direct buffers just work. Yeah? So just take that out as rule of thumb. I mean, there's always a use case for doing something else, but I think it's most of the things that you should do, actually. Find some pattern in a byte buff. In Netty 3, it was not called byte buff, it was called general buffer. So we just renamed it a few more methods, allowed message chaining, all that kind of stuff. But one of the cool things that we implemented there was we have now some kind, it's called a byte buff processor. It allows you to pass in a byte buff processor, which is called for each more byte until you return false. The good thing about that is, I mean, you can do that without that. The first example does that. But the problem is, for each buff get byte, we need to do an index check. So we check the range, which is expensive. And also for the read or write index and all that kind of things. With a byte buff processor, we can do that right up in front, because we know how long we can read. When it's passed in, we know we have, for example, 16 bytes that we are able to read, and after that, we can just stop. We don't need to do that range checks anymore. And besides that, it's also, well, I would say that on the other slides, it's pretty easy for the JIT compiler to inline that stuff. Without that, yeah, I said eliminate range checks, and also one thing that you can do, you can just create them and share them. I mean, it's just like a codec. You can just write them and you reuse them. We have that, for example, for stuff like delimiter-based frame decoder and this kind of stuff. We just have the created static, use them. As long as they have no state, you can just reuse them. And It's pretty fast. Then in Netty 3, most of the people, if they needed to get a channel buffer, they just used channel buffers, which has static method, which you can unpool stuff, which are not fast for the reasons like I said before. So what we now have, we have on the channel handler context, which is passed in for every method that's called, you can call alloc, which gives you the byte buff allocator, which may be a pooled one if you configure it like that. This way, you always make sure that you get a pooled buffer. And so you get the performance. Then another thing is always try to prefer slicing, duplicate over copy, because you don't want to memory copy if you don't need to. Just slice it. I mean, it's just for what the byte buff actually is. Just slice it, duplicate it. They have different reader-writer indexes. You share the memory or the bytes, and you don't need to memory copy. There are still some places where you want to copy, but most of the times it's just okay to slice, especially if you stay in one method, just to make it easier to work with. And also, you should really try to do poke operations on the buffer, because whenever you do a get byte, it does a range check. If you know you want to read a byte array, for example, with a length of 4, you can do it with a poke operation. There's no need to call 4 times get byte. You can just say get bytes. It's much cheaper, it's faster. You should do that. Often you have kind of protocols which have some header, for example, and have some payload, HTTP, WebSockets. There are a lot, MQTT, whatever. I mean, there's so many of them. And what you should do is you should implement byte buff holder or extend default byte buff holder, which is a default implementation for that. Because if you do so, you get the reference counting for free, which we use in Netty for our pool stuff. And you get all the handling of pool buffer and all that kind of things that happen when you write something to a socket for free. It's just faster. Because we know how we need to handle this kind of stuff, because it's so common message type to have a payload in the header. And also just release all this stuff out of the box. I mean, if it's written, the buffer is completely, it's just returned to the pool without you having to do anything. That works pretty well with the pool byte buffer allocator. File transfer. There are situations where you want to transfer some raw data out of files. There's something that's called zero memory copy for that. It's basically just send file on Linux. So whenever you want to do that, you basically should write the header first. For example, when you do HTTP, just write the header with the normal channel write, with the header is poach or whatever. And then after that, you don't pull out the file in the user space and write it to some byte buffer, because that's just slow. You don't want to do that. You use a file region for that. We have a file region. And again, we have some default implementation. You just use, you say, here, default file region, pass in the file channel, the offset, the length, write it right away, and we'll just get handled in the kernel without the need to pull it out in user space, which is much more faster, use less memory, and all that kind of things. So you should really do that. The only problem is it only works if you don't need to modify the starter. If you want to do encryption, compression, or whatever, you cannot do that. Or you need some kind of support in the kernel, because you don't pull it to user space, so you cannot access the starter. Because of that, we have something that's called a chunk write handler, which basically allows to write chunk stream implementation. The most common is the neo chunk file one or neo chunk stream. What we do there is we try to read from an inbound stream, for example, until there's nothing left. We try to check for that with just available calls on the method on the input stream and try. If it returns zero, we know there's nothing more before it starts to block. And we have some kind of flow control built in there, which also makes sure that you don't block too much, or it tries to prevent you from block, because if an input stream blocks, you block the IO thread. You don't want to do that because you have many connections on that. Because if you block one, you block 1,000, 100,000, whatever. It depends on how much connections, channels you have on one thread, one event loop. Also, the cool thing about these chunked write handlers, you can implement your own data type. I mean, you just need to implement chunked input handler, chunked stream, and then you can make use of the chunked write handler and have this kind of flow control. Yeah, like I said, never block the IO thread, the event loop. So don't use thread sleep because you think you need to wait for something. That's pretty bad. If you do that, you block everything on that thread. Countdown latch await, don't do that. Long-lived stuff or long-running stuff like compution or whatever, don't do that. If you need to do that, put it on an extra thread pool or whatever. If you're done, just put it back. It really helps to keep stuff running fast. I mean, for example, I think for Swift, you do something like this, right? Yeah. And also stuff like JDBC calls, because the problem really is Java was not made with non-blocking IO or non-blocking stuff in mind when it was created. So you have a lot of APIs actually out there that are just block, like JDBC or whatever. But because of this stuff, you can also, we have this kind of, it's called event executor group, which you can pass in if you add the handler to the channel pipeline. And if you do so, it will just get offloaded from the IO thread and can even have different from different handlers. You can even go back to the IO thread and all that kind of things. It's pretty flexible if you need it. Yeah, but another cool thing about the event loop is, which we now have in Netty 4, before you used maybe a hashed wheel driver, a hashed wheel timer, for example, or implementation of a timer. We now, with the event loop, what we do is we extend scheduled executor service. How does it work? I mean, it's pretty easy. We try to calculate, if you use non-blocking IO, we try to calculate which is the largest amount of time we want to block for the next select. And we pass that in when you do a select. And when the time is over, we run the task queue, which have scheduled stuff in there, and just execute it. And the pretty cool thing about that is it runs on the same thread than the other IO stuff for that channel. So you don't need to worry about synchronization. That's a pretty cool feature, I think. And it's pretty flexible. The only downside of that is it may be not 100% perfect in terms of when that stuff is run, because if someone blocks the IO thread, you're screwed, I mean. But I think that's true for all that kind of stuff for non-blocking IO, so you just need to care. But for most operation, it doesn't care if it runs in 10 milliseconds or 20 milliseconds later. It just needs to run in between this kind of time, and it saves you some threads. I mean, you could use a schedule executor service implementation which comes with the JDK, but you need more threads for that. With this, you don't need that, and it's all run by the same thread, no synchronization, no wire tie, whatever. Okay? What we now allow with Netty 4 is to reuse the event loop group. The thing was, in Netty 3, we allowed to pass in some kind of executor to fire up, it was called a channel factory. Yeah? But it was not be able to share that kind of stuff, at least at first. We later then changed that for non-blocking IO to allow to have a NIO worker pool, NIO boss pool. But it's still kind of, it's not flexible, because maybe you want to have the same event loop group to run for the boss and the worker. Basically, what the boss and the worker here is we call it like that. I mean, is that the boss one for a server accept the connections, and then it gets handed over to the worker to handle this kind of connections. So what we did in Netty 4 now actually was, it's just an event loop, and we are allowed to share the event loop. You can even use the same event loop for accepting and handling that connections, because often that's good enough. It may only be an issue if your I/O stuff is just keeping that stuff too busy and you cannot accept. So it queues up, goes over the backlog, and then just drop this stuff. So in these situations, you won't still use different ones. And what we also did was in Netty 3, we always had for the client a boss and a worker, which didn't make much sense after we think about that, because why you want to do connects with one thread and then switch over to another thread and handle the I/O? So we changed that in 94. Now it's only one event loop group which handles the connect and also the I/O for that kind of stuff. And even better, you can share that between the server and the client, the same event loop group, which minimizes all kind of threads that you need. Yeah, you see here how it's configured. I just put it there and how it's shared. But there's even more cool stuff about that. That's actually pretty interesting for all kind of applications that use proxy-like style. Because what we do, or what we allow in Netty 4 is, well, basically we have here the proxy-like implementation, which is not good, just to show how you should not do that. So what we do here is we have the channel active method, which is called when new connection comes in. So what we do there is we get the inbound channel, yeah, which is the one that we accepted. Then we create a new bootstrap, which is not bad. Put a new event loop group in there, which is kind of bad because it needs threads. And then we just say connect. Okay, that's it. And then after that, we can just handle that stuff. I mean, you still need to handle read from one channel right to another, but you can handle that. But you don't want to do that. Why you don't want to do that? First off, you create more thread than are needed. And the second one is, you need more context switching that you need, because the server channel that you accepted may not be on the same thread than the client channel you created to write the stuff to proxy it. So we thought about that, how we can solve that, and it's pretty easy, actually. Our event loop extends event loop group itself, because it's just an event loop group which has only one event loop in there, which is itself. So what you can do now is you get this inbound channel, which you just accepted, and create a new bootstrap and use the same event loop for the connection to make it outside. And that means they are running on the same thread. So whenever you read something from socket and write it to another socket, you don't need context switching. You just path the data through without context switching, without selector wakeups or anything. That's one of the things you could not do in Netty 3. So sometimes, I mean, the best is if you write out of the event loop, the I/O thread. But there are applications that have thread pools for whatever. And sometimes you want to call write out of them, just write something. That's pretty good. I mean, you can do that. It's thread safe. It works. The only problem for that is, if you call general write with a message, well, you create a new task internally that is put in the task queue. And then you call general write and flush, you create a new task that's put in the task queue, wake up the selector to pick it up. We just changed that. In previous releases of Netty 4, even the write was waking up the selector, which doesn't make any sense because it doesn't cause any syscall. But still, there's an overhead because you create one extra object for put it in the task queue now. So what you should do in this kind of sense, if you need to do multiple operations from out of the event loop, you can just get the event loop out for the channel and call execute on that because it extends schedule executor service. Put in a runnable and just do the two calls inside there. That saves an object. which is pretty good for GC pressure, especially if you have a lot of operations that you need to do. You can even pre-create them sometimes. It's a big win. So what you often do is you want to write from inside the event loop, right? And there are two different things that you can do to do that. You could call CTX channel write and flush, which basically means get me the channel that belongs to the channel handler context and call write and flush. Or you could do CTX write and flush. So what's the difference? I mean, the difference really that if you call write and flush on the channel, it will flow through the whole pipeline from the tail to the beginning, past every channel handler you have in there. Most of the times you don't need that. Most of the times you just want to write from the position of the channel handler that's in there. And if you do that with CTX, write and flush, or just write or whatever, it's a lot better in terms of performance because you don't need to pass all the channel handlers that may sit behind that one. So whenever possible, and that's almost all the cases, just use channel handler context write or channel handler context connect or whatever. There are some situations where you may want to start from the tail all the times, but it's pretty limited. And most of the times, it's a flaw in the application design that you just put the channel handler in the wrong position if you need to do that. Most of the time, the outbound handler which handles this kind of stuff sit at the first. And then there come the inbound handler sit later. You can share channel handlers, which basically means we put an annotation on that. And that means you can add the same channel handler instance to multiple channels or multiple channel pipelines, which again reduce GC overhead, whatever. Maybe it's expensive to create it for whatever reasons. You can just share them. Here we have some example which just uses stateless handler because it should be stateless at least because otherwise it will not work because you will use it for different threads, different channels, and just put in the pipeline. That's it. We just fixed one performance problem with that in the latest Netty release because the thing is if you put an annotation on that and check for an annotation, it goes to some synchronized stuff in the OpenJDK or Java itself. So we cache that now. So the first time we run that, it's get cache and thread local with some map inside there. Yeah, you can look it up. It's pretty funny. We have an open closed issue for that. There are the performance number in there. So it gives some overhead conditions, whatever. If you create a lot of concurrent connections, because we need to check that on each new connection that's created. You should remove the channel handler if you don't need that anymore because it keeps your pipeline short, and if the pipeline is short, it's faster. So what do you often have, for example, for web sockets? You have the handler in, the HTTP, and once the upgrade is done, you can just move all the HTTP stuff because you don't need it anymore. You should do that for every protocol that just supports something like that. If you're done with that, just throw it away because that makes things fast. You should use a proper buffer type in your message to byte encoder. The message in byte encoder actually does it transform a POCHO and allows you to write it to a byte buff. So it gets written to the socket. By default, it will just use the default buffer type from your allocator, which may be direct. But if you, for example, want to use Sazzle or whatever, you need to work with arrays. So you can pass in some hind. False means prefer heap buffers, and then you can access the array directly. You can just get the offset of the array right directly in the array. You just need to remember to update the indexes on the byte buff itself because, well, you don't write through the byte buff. But there, especially if you talk to old APIs, there are use cases for that. Also for setlib, whatever, deflate, with inflator, deflator, you need to do that kind of stuff. That saves some byte copy because otherwise you would need to write to a byte array and then write it to the byte buff, which is direct. Okay? Auto read or not to auto read. That's new in Netty 4, actually. In Netty 3, what happens was whenever there's something that is ready to get read, because you have the read offset for the channel and selector, it just gets pushed through the pipeline. And you need to handle that. If you don't want to handle that, you need to remove this op. So what we allow in Netty 4 now is you can set auto read on and off. Default is on, which means it acts like in Netty 3, it just fires off. But you can also say false, which means you need to call general read that says, OK, I'm ready to read one byte buffer now. Whatever is ready on the channel, I'm ready to read that now once it comes in. And after that, it's fired through the pipeline. And once you call general read again, it will do the next read. And that's pretty flexible, especially if you do proxy applications where you may have a slow backend and a fast frontend, because you don't want to buffer all that kind of stuff because they're writing fast, but you're not be able to write fast enough out. Though that's, again, allows some kind of flow control, which are pretty good for proxies, for example. Or maybe you just want to have this full control when you want to read and when you don't want to read. Because if you don't call read and auto read is off, it doesn't have the read offset on the selector anyway, so it will not get waked up for that. Okay? Encryption. Anyone use Java encryption, SSL stuff? Was it fast? In Java 8, it's better than Java 7. I don't know if we would call it pretty good, but it's better, yeah. But what you can do for this kind of stuff is the guys of Twitter have basically written an open SSL-based SSL engine and can just pass it in the SSL handler itself, which means you use open JDK bindings, which is a lot faster than the Java stuff. The Firebase guys actually do that. It's a lot more faster than handshaking, right? And it produces less GC. Also, the Java implementation has some kind of overhead with caching, this kind of stuff that you need to tune, because otherwise it will just close up if you have not a lot of connections. That's a lot better than the OpenJDK stuff. And because, well, I'm bored anyway, I'm currently working on an OpenJDK-based SSL handler directly using Java native interface. It's even more faster and integrated with Netty. I mean, it's fun to write Java native interface. Yeah, kind of. No, it's not fun. Well, yeah, it's interesting. Yeah, you see here how it's configured, and there's a link to the Finagle stuff where you can just grab it. It's part of Finagle, but you can just use it with Netty itself. There's even a blog post from Firebase how to use it, so you can just research.
Does this have like the normal native problems where you have to do like a thread save every time
you're
calling into it?
Is there a latency? I don't know exactly why the JDK implementation is so much slow because OpenJDK, OpenSSL, because, well, I'm not an SSL guy. I just know it's a lot faster. We did test that, and especially for handshaking, it's a lot faster. You can talk to the Firebase guys later. They know that, yeah. Okay? Some MISC stuff. We use channel features that get returned for every operation you do on the channel, for example, a write, a connect, or whatever. The thing is, you never know when it's get nullified. I mean, it may be written out pretty fast, it may be not. So you should take care to actually don't use too much inner classes, which are not static, because you may hold a reference to the outer class, which may have some big stuff in there, which stick in the memory, because we cannot release it, because we need it. I mean, you want to notify that. So make sure you use static instance, static final stuff when you do your inner classes. Don't use anonymous stuff, only if you don't have a big class, because otherwise you have a lot of problems again with memory. Yeah, because I love Java native interface. We wrote a new native transport for Netty. We don't use Java NIO at all. We just use Java Native Interface in C and use epoll edge triggered directly. Because it's a pretty good fit for the model of Netty itself, because we push the data anyway. I mean, normally with level triggered, you may read it out, but maybe not. But with Netty, we push it down the pipeline anyway. So it's a pretty good fit for the event model of edge triggered here to get better latency and less overhead. Because also, one of the things is in the Open JDK or Oracle JDK, whatever, there's a lot of synchronization going on in there. It's basically because they need to support some pretty generic stuff. I mean, we don't need to do that. We know in Netty that only one thread is handling one channel, so we don't need to synchronize in this kind of terms, like in selection key or whatever. I mean, if you read, maybe if one of you read the selection key Java doc at some point of time, I think it's called like, it may block for some time. What that means, I have no idea. Often it's pretty fast, but it may block. It sounds a little bit bad for non-blocking IO. So, yeah, I thought it would be fun to just write something in C. So we implemented our own native transport, which only works on Linux. It's pretty new, so I wouldn't call it stable, but if you're brave enough, you can try it out, get feedback, break it, whatever, and we will make it just amazing. I mean, the cool thing is it's edge-triggered, it has less GC because we just pass around basically an array of longs for the pointers, for the different events. We don't need to have a hash map, whatever. We just put this stuff around. So not much GC. We even support TCP Cork. I don't know if you know what TCP Cork is, so I would just explain. In TCP Cork, you're allowed to basically, for example, HTTP, where you want to write some file back. So what you actually want to do with this kind of stuff is you do write the headers first as byte buff, and then you do zero memory copy stuff with a file region, which is called send file. But the thing is, for that, you may need to, the kernel may need to have two buffers that get sent over the network, at least two. One for the byte buff itself, and one for the file region. With TCP Cork, the kernel tries to minimize that. So it tries to pack, actually, the other stuff together, and so you minimize the round trips, the stuff that you're writing on the network. It's faster for this kind of stuff, but it only works on Linux. I think it also works on BSD and that kind of stuff, but we only implemented it for Linux yet, because that was most used in production anyway. I mean, I'm working for Red Hat, what should I say? So, yeah, but maybe we think about to also support for KQ, for BSD, FreeBSD, OS X, but yeah, I don't think someone runs OS X on a server anyway, so BSD mainly. Switching to the native transport is pretty easy, actually. The first stuff, it's just the non-plugin IO, which you actually use, which is our JDK stuff. And after that, you see what you do with the native stuff. It's just two changes, and that's it. The rest is just the same. Same API. It's a drop-in replacement, actually, which is pretty cool. Yeah. You want to know more? Buy my book, Make Me Rich. I want to retire pretty soon. You need to buy a lot of books. Maybe 1,000, everyone? I don't know. Yeah, make me rich. No, I'm not getting rich off that. So if you're interested, just buy that. If you want to buy that, drop by. I have some discount code, so you don't make me rich at all. Yeah. If you not buy it, it's also cool, but if you buy it, it's even better. It's formatting. And yeah, that's the references. I mean, that's just a Netty project. First UL, everything is well done with ASCII doctor and DC slides. It's pretty awesome. You don't need to know much HTML or whatever. You can just have some shiny presentation. It's written by Dan Allen, Sarah White, and everything, all the pictures are Creative Commons license. So feel free to grab everything, use it, whatever you want. I'm happy if you do. Just say that Netty works if you do so. All right? So that's it. It's basically questions. I will hopefully remember to repeat the questions for the microphone. So anyone? Is it a good sign? Yes, sir?
Even better.
So in Netty 4, there's a guarantee that all the events for a channel will be processed in one event loop.
Yeah.
But it also provides the possibility that you can assign a different event group to a handler. So what's the usage of assigning a different event loop?
It's basically what we do in Netty 4 for that to make it work is basically we check if the next event executor, which is assigned to the channel handler, if you don't specify anyone, it's just the event loop itself. If it's not the same, we dispatch an event in the task queue and let it run. We want to do that, for example, JDBC call. It's pretty typical. I mean, you just offload the work to another thread pool, and you can even move it back later. The next handler, if you don't specify anything, it just goes back to the IO thread. This way, you can even use some stage execution stuff, like have this handler with that, this, whatever. I mean, it really depends what you do. I mean, what is blocking? It really depends. It depends on the traffic, the throughput, what you expect. I mean, writing and reading for the file system, it may be pretty fast, maybe not. You're running maybe on NFS. You don't know. So it's pretty up to the application itself. I mean, some people just, if they do some writes on the file system reading, they just do it in the IO thread. Because if you use SSD or whatever, it's pretty fast. It really depends on your application. But that JDBC, for example, is a pretty good fit for this extra kind of stuff. Okay?
Hey, I actually have a bunch of questions for you. It's great talking to you.
A bunch of questions.
Okay. It's great talking to you outside of Twitter. But I will... in less than 140 characters, rather.
Go ahead.
But yeah, I wanted to go with the kind of higher questions or so that it applies to everyone. I don't know, I walked a little late. Did you talk about Netty 5 at all, about what the goals are there?
I can do.
Yeah.
Maybe that would be not bad, huh?
Yeah, I'm curious.
Yeah, we tried to be pretty smart with Netty 4. It worked out, kind of. Like always. So we plan to do some changes in Netty 5 to address some of the issues we found after Netty 4 was used in production. There are a few issues. Most of the people don't be affected at all, but if you are. First off, I mean, this event loop thing, like you have one thread for a channel handler, for a channel, whatever, it's pretty awesome because it makes things pretty easy to do. But it's also kind of limited, maybe. So what can happen actually now is when you accept a new connection from a server, when you're a server, we just look up in the event loop group the next event loop to use to put that channel on. It's round robin, basically. It's pretty easy. That works well, pretty well, when you start. But if you have a long-running application which use maybe different workloads, maybe you do HTTP, whatever, telnet, on the same event loop group, it starts to get unbalanced, maybe, because some connections are long-living, some are not long-living, some pushing more data, some not pushing more data. So what can happen if it runs for a while is that one event loop is a lot hotter than the others, because it's just more loaded. That's pretty bad. In terms of throughput. So, actually, we thought, yeah, we fixed that in 84. We didn't fix that. What we try to do is we allow to let the user deregister the channel from the event loop by himself and put it somewhere else. That didn't work for different reasons. One of the reasons is it kind of destroys the life cycle. because the channel should be connected to some thread. Because what we want, what we should do if someone calls an IO operation and it's not connected to a thread, which thread should notify it? I have no idea. Maybe the calling thread? It depends. It's just not good from the philosophy of design. Well, that's one of the mistakes. Then the other mistake we actually made was we thought, yeah, okay, it works like this, and now we want to register again. First off, are you sure that all the pending stuff in the old event loop are handled yet? If you put it on another event loop, new stuff may come in and the old stuff is not handled yet, you get out of order, which is pretty bad for most stuff. Not for all, but for most of the stuff. And the other thing is, I mean, we try to guarantee that your handler is only handled by one IO, by one thread. So if we move over to another thread, are you sure that you see all the changes on all your files that you maybe have in your channel handler? I'm not sure yet. I mean, so basically it doesn't work. So what we do to fix that in Netty 5 now is, first off, we make the lifecycle more tightly. I mean, before you was allowed to create, for example, a new socket channel, and then later you register on the event loop. That's not possible anymore. You now create it and pass in the event loop in the constructor. So once it's created, it's tied to a thread. And we also removed the deregister method because it didn't work. What we want to do is we provide a re-register method and handle this kind of stuff by ourselves, because we know actually when all the stuff is handled by that channel that is in the task queue, and then we can switch over. We just need to make sure that we have some kind of memory barrier so that every changes are visible on different threads. But that's not good enough. The other thing is that we will have probably a student working on for Google Sum of Code is we want to provide some way to make it possible to plug in different event loop selectors. So at the moment it's just round robin, which is okay for most things. But what we want to do is we want to get some metrics out of the event loop implementation, like how many stuff is in the task queue, how long it plugs on the select, how long a full run through the pipeline was for each channel, and this kind of stuff, because that really tells you how busy that stuff is. And then push back the matrix to the selector, and in the select implementation, use the matrix to pick the best event loop for now. So we will ship default implementation like round robin, like less use and this kind of stuff, but you're also free to just implement your own. That fixes one of the problems, like choosing the right one when new stuff comes in, but it doesn't fix the problem what happens with long-living stuff. Though the other thing is what we want to do is auto-rebalance to support that. So when we detect that one event loop is hotter than the other, we just move the channel over to another one to kind of allow to still work. So it basically just auto-balance under the hood for you and move on channels. If one is pretty hot, the other is just idling, just move the channel. You have memory barriers, and then you see everything like you need to see, right? What actually from Netflix, huh? The idea? It was pretty good. We're already working on that. I mean, we do prototype, but it's not too easy to do. I mean, to do it right. All right? Anything there? More questions from you, maybe? Not? You can just go ahead. I mean, I have time.
Well,
just take the mic.
Sure, thanks. I came in late. I don't know if you talked about this. I'm now running into the problem that the Linux behavior changed after the Linux kernel 3.10 around SIOC, REUT port, adder, or whatever. Reuse port and reuse adder.
Yeah.
Is this like something that Netty can help me with? Is there a solution for this?
Actually, I'm not sure.